Hello, malty mates, making merry. I'm Ralphie. Welcome to Whisky Review 554 here in the Manx Bothy, somewhere floating gently in the middle of the Irish Sea and not a storm cloud in sight. Thank goodness. Before we continue, thank you to Brian Jepson for that malt mention. Well, we need a malt mention. Oh, yes, we do, because we're going to be mentioning a malt. A single malt from Scotland called Mortlach. Now, for some of you malt mates and Ralphie fans, there may be a little bit of a groundhog moment, because back in Whisky Review 24, I reviewed a predecessor of this Mortlach. I'm going to tell you why I bought another bottle, and I'm going to tell you how they compare, really, over the space of, what, 5 years? That's the difference between Whisky Review 554 and Whisky Review 24. But first of all, this particular malt. The reason I buy independent bottlings of Mortlach is because I really like Mortlach as a style of single malt. It's got character. It's a bit like Lagavulin and Kleinlish and Springbank and Macallan and Glenfarclas and take your pick. It's got real interesting characteristics, and when it matures well, it matures brilliantly. It might not necessarily be a full-on maturation. It could be a subtle, delicate maturation, and it can work incredibly well and even at times behave like an old lowland single malt. That is the nature of Mortlach. It's actually quite a chameleon malt. You get many various permutations, all rolled into one brand new word you haven't heard before, vermuations, right? You get these styles and characters within this characteristic malt, and it's hard to pin down, and I could talk about Mortlach for quite a while, about the fact that they use worm tubs for cooling, the fact that they stopped direct firing their stills in 1971 and should start direct firing their stills again in 2017 or whatever. It's not going to happen. But I don't buy official bottlings of Mortlach, because they're now packaged and presented in 50 centilitre bottles. Why? So as the producers can make more money, malt mates. That's why. That's the reason. It's called branding. A result of which you may occasionally see official bottlings of Mortlach discounted in some of the bigger whisky stores, because it doesn't sell quite as vigorously as it could if they actually sold the whisky for its intrinsic quality rather than for the presentation and marketing appendages. And that, malt mates, was an opinion, right? I'm carefully noticing. This is one of these whiskies. I've got to talk for a minute after I've poured a glass, because it really needs time to just kind of calm down a little bit. This is one feisty young malt monster. It really is. Distilled in 1990, bottled at 24 years of age. And this is cask number 6079, for those of you who wish to know. Bottled at 56.5%. And it's a very typical example of an independent bottling. So it's not like the official house style of official bottlings, which tend to be carefully blended for continuity. This is really a variation in the theme, and it comes across as such. And what comes across is just how intense and slightly aggressive, and it's a good example of how a strong-willed malt and a strong-willed cask haven't really got on that well together over the years. Let me explain. Nose. Oh, astringent, bitter, sour, woody, definitely woody. But the woodiness is kind of challenged by the sheer personality, of some pretty intact spirit, even after 24 years, because Mortlach can do that. It can really hang on in there over time with the character of the spirit. When you taste it, strong, powerful, peat smoke, hot ash, hot ash, chili, pickled ginger. This is one aggressive young pup that needs a little bit of taking in hand, and well, it's not so young. And this is what I'm going to do. Now, normally I would use a spoon. However, you're talking about, what, 30 mil in that glass? I'm more than happy to double it with water, reducing the strength of the alcohol in there down to 26-27%. Now, that may seem rather excessive, even by my standards, malt mates. It is, actually. But there's many whiskies would drown under that much water. Literally, the character, the complexity, everything would just disappear and it would taste dilute. It would taste like a reasonable and interesting house wine. That's what would happen. However, not with this one. No. Perfume notes. Beautiful smoke. Lagavulin style of smoke. A little hint of peatiness, distinct. Green fruits. Gooseberries. Yeah. Kiwi fruit. Yeah. Sour mash, like bourbon sour mash, definitely. And honey notes, sherry notes. Tasting it. It tastes as intact as many single malts bottled at 40%. It still gets such substance to it. It needs the water. It is so... It literally, it's as if for the past 24 years, a strong-willed cask and a strong-willed spirit have been declaring war on each other. Kid you not. What an experience, what a form here going on. Neat, it's really quite unpalatable. That's the fact of it. With plenty of water. And I mean, don't overload it with water, but you can double the volume with water and you will still get a decent whiskey. Such is the busyness that's been going on in this cask. I admit, you lose a bit in the nose, definitely. But in the palate, what you're getting is a still proactive spirit after 24 years and a cask which has, they've met in the middle, they're not getting on, but it's as if they've declared a truce, so they're cohabiting. Typical, like, just like a human relationship. And the flavours, rich honey raisin arrival, bitter oak, but sherry bitter oak, something slightly oily, vanilla, lemon rind, grapefruit, gooseberry, kiwi. So you're getting the green, slightly underripe fruits there. Touch of apple. It's a characteristic of Mortlach. And then you get that savoury note, that little meatiness that you have. It's not particularly meaty here, it's not particularly savoury here, it's more floral and fresh fruit, but it's definitely there. And it's the characteristic of Mortlach. It is a savoury malt. It's one of the few examples of that. That's a very old-fashioned style of malt. And it's just purely down to the provenance of the location of the distillery, which was actually built on top of a well which was used by illegal distillers, the illicit distillers they call them. I won't call them illicit distillers, I'll just call them perfectly reasonable entrepreneurs. that's what we'll call them, illegal distillers, illicit. Illegal in whose eyes? The greedy bastards. The greedy leaders of society who are always in the take and the make in the name of communal goodwill, or the initiative within a local community for the greater gain of the individual to the benefit of the wider community, within the community. Yeah, there we go. I won't digress any further. A really interesting whiskey once you get to know it. And you'll find this, there's many whiskies that when you go through your usual drill of adding a certain amount of water or not adding water at all, perhaps adding ice, you might find that it's not really hitting the button. It's not giving you that bliss point. It's only when you start to play around with it. You know, sure, put the bottle in the fridge. Don't put it in the freezer, please. That just kills the smell and taste completely. Put it in the fridge if you want to, so it can warm up in the ambient temperature of your room. And perhaps you'll hit the bliss point there. And the bliss point, of course, is that moment when you've got the whiskey and you're really getting it. It hasn't started that way, but you arrive at it and you know it when you find it. That is the bliss point. The bliss point of this whiskey is 5 minutes away. Seriously. It's getting there. That rich toffee, soft, slightly over scotch toffee note is starting to come through from the sweetness of the cask, which was completely oblivious previously due to the bitterness of the oak wood. But it's the sweetness of the sherry cask now, rather than the oak wood itself, which is starting to exert and make its appearance more known. And that's happened because I've added sufficient water now to allow it. Malt marker of 100. I'm going to give this 86 out of 100. It's a malt mark. You're wondering where the tin is? This comes in a tin. It's a lovely tin, a useful tin. It's not the sort of tin that I throw out after I've finished the bottle. But I had to post something rather fragile to somebody and I picked up the wrong tin because they all look the same for these kind of bottlings. All kind of black ones, you know. With the oval black tins with the little labels with the oval lids. And I put the fragile thing in it and bubble wrap and posted it off so I don't have it to accompany the bottle. It would usually sit there, but we don't have one today. Sorry. Mortlach. I reviewed a predecessor of this back in Whiskey Review 24. It lasted 5 minutes 30 seconds. Oh, those were the days when patience wasn't a virtue. And it was distilled 1988, cask number 2652, bottled at 59.6%. And it was arguably the finest Mortlach and probably find one of the finest malts I'd ever tasted because it wasn't the usual presentation of Mortlach. It was subtle. It was understated. It was hugely long. 5 years later, very different. Only 2 years of a difference between the casks, between the distillates, sorry. The casks could be relatively similar. They could be from the same bodega, but hugely different whiskies. Hugely different. It's night and day. And this is what happens when you find official bottlings getting too expensive, as some are. You start to look a little more interest at the independent bottlings. Because not only may they be cheaper, not always, sometimes be cheaper and more available where you are, but also their cask strength, unchill filtered and natural colour. And when you're paying more and more for older whiskies, you want reassurances that you're getting the most authentic that the product could be. And it's even when the official bottlers are not adding colourant to an older whiskey, you know, they should say on the label so as we really know and are not left guessing or waiting for an email response from the distillery. It's called being practical and respecting the customer. Hint, hint, distillers. And, the bliss point has arrived, malt mates. That's actually better than they give it credit for. Mortlach, once it reveals itself, is just such a wonderful malt. It's 2.5 times distilled, a bit like Springbank. They've got this little, 6 stills, they've got a little still, micro still almost, at the end of the line called the Witchy Still. And some of the distillate from double distillation gets put through this. There's no hard and fast rules, it appears, and they're not quite sure whether it actually, to the extent to which it affects the final product, but it does influence it. And you get this particular personality of Mortlach, which really floats my boat. It does. And I'm just not prepared to pay for official bottlings. I'm not prepared to pay for the packaging and presentation and all the flannel behind it. So I avoid them. Simple as that. And they're generally expensive. And I just concentrate on enjoying whatever independent bottlings I can find. And when I can't find them, I'll no longer buy the whisky. Period. Can you see the Scotch mist? This is such a floral fruit, Mortlach, now. The syrupiness, that harshness right at the beginning, it's gone. It's totally gone. A whole different experience. The mouth feels tremendous, wonderfully oily. Mint, peppermint. That's what I was wondering what was going on there. Green peppermint, green mint, slight absinthe note, gentian. Wormwood. Beautiful. Worm tubs are still used for cooling at Mortlach. Worm tubs are where the vapour coming out of the still going down the line arm, instead of going into a condenser, which would be more efficient, goes into a spiral of copper inside a cold water tub, and it means that you have more copper contact over a slightly longer time generally for the cooling process of the vapour back into liquor. This has a huge influence. Really, more distillers should use worm tubs, but there we go. Keep an eye on Mortlachs. If you see them before you buy an independent bottling, go online and check out reviews, because unfortunately I've tasted some really bad independent bottlings of Mortlach which were just sour cask. So be warned, be advised, ask the guy at the shop. And do you know what? The best incentive for anyone to buy a whisky is the opportunity to get a little tiny taste first of all. Taste and try before you buy. It works. Next, I have a little note list here. 3 items on it to conclude Whisky Review 554 before I wander off and finish this delightful single malt and have a cup of tea and a slice of toast, buttered toast. Well, first of all, thank you, all you malt mates who have followed my recent photographic art exhibition at Inverarity Vaults in Glasgow. All the pictures have now sold. Thank you for your support, and thank you to all you malt mates who bought my pictures. Much appreciated. I'll be in touch with you shortly to get your address and contact details so I can post out your pictures. Secondly, thank you to all you maltmates who attended Ralphie's Whisky Evening at the Good Spirits Company in Bath Street in Glasgow a couple of weeks ago. It was billed not as a masterclass with a brand ambassador. There's plenty of them out there. Masterclasses are two a penny these days, maltmates. What I in fact hosted was a disaster class held by a disreputable upstart. Yep, fair enough. And the idea was, as it introduced each of the whiskies, which were all over 40% unchill filtered and natural colour, by the way. Very good. I mentioned how to avoid whisky disasters. So there were six different topics in avoiding a whisky disaster, all very significant, pertinent, and perhaps I might tell yourselves someday. And we raised £433 for a food bank in Glasgow. Very importantly, one of the staff who works at the shops is a volunteer at the food bank. And regrettably, they're a sign of the times in Britain in 2015, which seems a bit absurd, you might think. But the human condition is a bit absurd. There you go. Natural law strikes again. But £433 goes a long, long way towards feeding families who need food. Period. So it was good to connect with the Good Spirits Company to do some good in the community. That matters. Finally, for all you avid whisky collectors in particular, but malt mates in general, at scotchwhiskyauctions.com at this moment in time, this is Sunday the 25th of September 2015, so we're a bit time sensitive here. I have three whisky items up for auction to raise money for my Bonneville Land Speed World Record attempts next year in 2016. So go along and have my look at them, maltmates, because I've provided a link below to send you there. Yeah, I have three items. A case of Octomore Futures, which has had a reserve on it. And I don't like to put reserve in things, but I had to put one in this because an actual case of Octomore's never appeared at auction before. This is truly a first. But it had to be a case because of the provenance of the certificates and other stuff attached to make it truly authentic. I also have a two-box bottle of Macallan 60th anniversary, silver jubilee, no, platinum jubilee, what is it, golden, anyway, 60th anniversary bottling, and a Chivas 100 malts. There you go. So three very different collectible items, differently presented. If you do wish to bid, have a happy bidding. I will be using the money to send a motorbike to America and to hire a van to take it up to Utah to race on the Bonneville Salt Lakes. Okie dokie. It's looking good, looking promising. Work is progressing. I am a dreadful mechanic, but fortunately I know some very good mechanics who are, for the benefit of health and safety, asking me to just step aside and do other jobs while they actually get on, because they know what they're doing in preparing the bike. Needs must. Anyway, here's to you. A slightly cloudy Scotch mist whiskey, as you know. A better version of whatever version it is. And please join me shortly for Whisky Review 555. I don't even know what I'm going to be reviewing yet, but it will be generally quite available single malt or Irish whiskey. Not quite sure yet. Watch this space.